Welcome to the lecture this morning. We have with us a gentleman here on the couch who is a keyboardist, arranger, producer, music director, and he's been a part of some of the recordings that have defined an era and a generation. So won't you please welcome Mr. Greg Phillinganes. Welcome.
Thank you. I mean, thank you. It's great to be here.
I'd like to actually start, just because everybody's come in from food or whatever conversation they've been having or session that they just came out of, with a little bit of music just to reset our ears. Going to play something from Greg's career, featuring a few people who were pivotal figures in your career. This song was produced by Quincy Jones, written by Stevie Wonder, and features a singer named Michael Jackson. The song is titled I Can't Help It, and it features Greg on keyboards, electric piano, synthesizer.
Yes, all that.
All right.
So, you know, I get asked many times, well, do you remember what's going on in the studio then? And then I go, no, I don't. I don't remember. But this, I remember just about everything. Because the funny thing about this was that, as you mentioned, it was written by Stevie, you know. And we heard the demo that he sent. And it wasn't like this at all. It was completely different. It was a lot more Latin influenced, you know, and it was based more off of an acoustic piano. So, well, here, just sort of. No, right now I gotta find an acoustic piano. Hang on. It was more like you know, more like a Night in Tunisia kind of thing. You know what I mean? It's like, well, this is gonna be cool, you know. And Quincy actually asked me to kind of junior produce this. So I thought, well, this is fantastic. I mean, what an honor. I mean, this is going to be great. So I took the demo, and I thought, well, I'm just going to recreate the demo, right? So, you know, I set it all up, and I played on it, and I had Sheila E. come down and play percussion. And I remember, you know, watching her do overdubs in the booth, and I thought, oh, this is going to be great, man. This is going to be fantastic. And I think it was in that key too, E flat, originally. And so I get it all together, and I'm ready to present this to Quincy, and I play it for him, and I go, "What do you think?" He goes, "No, no, it's not really what I had in mind at all." And I was like, so then he explained. He explained to me the same way that Count Basie explained to Neil Hefti when he brought in this tune, because Neil Hefti was this hot young arranger at the time, and he brought in this tune called Little Darling, I believe it was called. And it was, you know, really fast, you know, and very energetic, you know, and the melody was like, you know, and Neil thought he was going to really impress Count Basie with this, you know, hot up-tempo tune. And when Count Basie heard it, he was like, you're missing the point. So what Basie did in his genius was he slowed it down and made it sexy so you could hear every note of the melody. And it completely changed the dynamic of the song. So the reason why I'm explaining that is because that's the same thing Quincy said to me about Can't Help It. He said, no, this is Michael. We got to make it sexy. Because because this was, and it was on the Off the Wall album, right?
Right.
So this was Michael's coming out as an adult, not the bubblegum kid anymore. So, you know, this was his statement, like, I'm grown up now and I'm grown and sexy. So that's how Quincy wanted to present him. So he said, no, you got to slow it down, make it sexier. And then when he explained it to me and we put it in a different key, then I went, oh, I get it. I really get it now. So he, you know, Quincy set up the parameters. He set up the new foundation for us to play off of. And then when I got that, I was all over it then. So I did the bass, the synth bass, the sexy synth bass, and the beautiful Rhodes. And I remember there was this synthesizer called an Oberheim OB-8, right? And the beautiful thing about that was it had these modules that you connected together, but one of the best features about the OB-8 was that you could play several notes. It was polyphonic. You could play several notes at a time, but you could set it to where each note had its own portamento, meaning, you know, you hit a note and it would, the time it takes to go from one note to the next, you could set that individually. So when you hit each note, you never knew how long it was going to take to get to the next note. So you had, like, you'd play a chord and you go, and then you'd hear, and then you'd play a note down here in your left hand and it would go, and it'd go. So you had this beautiful, creamy wall of sound, and that's what you're hearing on top of the Rhodes. And they led me on that thing, and I went crazy. I was just like, oh, this is fantastic. So that's why you...
He's not excited.
So when you hear it in the track, that's when you're hearing all this, you know. And then I did a sort of like a solo lead line, and I, you know, implemented that same feature with the portamento. So it was just a gorgeous process, and it was a valuable lesson learned. But I learned it, so. That's the story about that. So I'm going to come back over here. Was that informative?
Very much so.
Was that good?
Thank you for that.
Was that good?
I don't even have to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's good. I don't even have to ask any questions.
Well, yeah. So I hope y'all got nothing to do. We could be here a while. I don't know. But anyway, yeah. That's what I remember about that.
A colleague of yours, well, I guess let's establish this.
Yeah.
You were a session keyboardist for many years.
Yeah.
How do you define the role of what a session keyboardist is? I mean, obviously, this was beyond that for this particular track. But what do you view that session, role as?
Yeah, a session musician, regardless of instrument, is a person who has evolved in the craft of making records. Well, that was back then. That was back then when I was your age. Things have changed now. You kids don't know. You kids don't know nothing about this. But you see, the difference is that the process of making records these days is vastly different. You know, you can make a record with this. This is making a record right here. Well, back in my day, what we used to do is we used to all get together in a room called a studio. It was a studio, and we'd have a guy in a booth. He was an engineer. That's all he did was engineer. He had a big thing. It was called a well, you know what I'm talking about. We had a console, we had engineers, and we had musicians. We had a recording studio. We had a producer. Everybody had their roles. And you'd go in and, you would either hear the demo of the track you were going to work on, or you'd have charts, or both. And... it was between the musicians in the room and the producer to kind of
bring a new evolution from the demo that would be inspirational for the artist and everyone involved. Basically, Quincy's motto was, "Well, if it doesn't give me goosebumps, how can I expect anybody else to dig it?" You know, but that was the idea. And while it may seem foreign to some that, you know, a bunch of guys could actually, you know, get in a room and create music at the same time, that was normal for us. But it was, you know, it was such a golden age because we literally learned how to make records, you know, how to make finished products in all different kind of genres. You know, I mean, one day you'd be in a studio with Willie Nelson, next day you'd be in a studio with Barbara Streisand, next day you'd be in a studio with, you know, Lionel Richie or whoever, or George Benson, you know, and you just learned, and it was a fantastic process. And you had, you had to deal with different personalities, different producers with their different methods, their different techniques. Imagine being in a room and you're doing an overdub with a producer who says, you know, I need to make this a little more green. Now, you're sitting there thinking, okay, what the hell is he talking about? But, you know, then you're going through your mind and, you know, based on your experience, and based on what you're listening to, and based upon the fact that you know the producer that's talking to you is crazy and probably stoned out of his mind, doesn't even know what the hell he's talking about, you go, well, yeah, green, okay, let me check that out. And then you play something, and he goes, yeah, that's it. Now you've done your job. Right. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, that's what it was like, you know?
Did you feel confined in any way as a musician? I mean, you basically, you're performing this craft, using your skills, but you're also assigned to a very specific thing too.
Yeah, but that's the beauty of it, because, you know, it's people think that, well, I just need to be limitless, you know. But it, actually, the more parameters you have, the more creative you can be, because you understand how far you can go. So now, what can I do within this set of parameters? What can I do within these boundaries that will make this work? So that's actually the challenge of it, and the joy is the result you get from that.
Right.
You know.
Right.
A colleague of yours, Michael Boddicker, I believe.
Yeah.
Fellow keyboardist.
Yeah.
He once said that you had the deepest pocket of since the Mariana Trench. What do you think that means in terms?
Can you explain?
Not literally deep pockets.
No, but I know what he means. He pocket has it refers to groove, you know, and the ability to groove without rushing or slowing down. Yeah. That's what he meant. And pocket was really the ultimate compliment that one musician could give to another, because it meant that, you know, there was this space in between the groove that if you rest in it, that's the butter. That's what feels good, you know? And so, you know, for drummers playing just a basic thing like, you know, and whatever you play rests in that and it doesn't feel rushed and it doesn't feel behind, that's the pocket.
How did you develop that?
Well,
you started young, didn't you?
There's a story to that. But I would just say the experience of playing with different kinds of musicians. Because while listening to you know, recordings of your inspirations is very important. Nothing will expand your musicianship more than just getting in a room with guys and girls and just going at it, mm-hmm. you know?
How did you start playing the piano?
How did I? You mean from the very beginning, or? Well, I started at 2, and I don't mean PM. I started when I was 2 years old, and I started, you know, playing by ear. And I would go to my next door neighbor's house. I'm from Detroit, and I would go to my next door neighbor's. They, in their basement, they had an old piano, and I would spend a lot of time there. My mom didn't really know what I was doing, you know, where I was spending all my time. So when she found out, she went downtown to a music store called Grinnell's and bought me this piano, this upright, beautiful, ornate, upright piano. And I would, it became my new best friend. Mm-hmm. And I would sit on it and, you know, I'd play some things that were rhythmic. And so to compensate for that, I would kick the panel, the lower panel of it to you know, make percussion. So I'd be playing it. I actually remember doing that, which is crazy, much to my mom's delight. And then around 6 years old, I started taking formal lessons till about the age of, and I had 3 different teachers. You know, the first one was obviously doing the elementary stuff, and then there was more of a mid-level instructor, but the third one was the most influential. And mom actually managed to get the pianist with the Detroit Symphony Orchestra to, you know, to instruct me. And his name was Misha Kotler. And he was one rough customer. He was quite intimidating. He could take this middle finger like this and crack a pane of glass. He was that strong, you know. And I left his place many times with my head between my legs, you know, because he was really quite intimidating, but he was what I needed, you know, as far as discipline.
Yeah, I mean, so you were studying classically.
I was studying classical, yeah.
What did that bring you as a player, do you think?
Along with discipline, just, you know, an expansion and appreciation for that genre, and it just expanded my musicality because, you know, that's one genre that I'm able to incorporate in others that, you know, that I play. Because, you know, you can incorporate elements of that in pop, yeah. You know, in jazz. You know, very famous artists and bands, the Beatles did that, you know. So it was a wonderful resource to have.
Detroit. Yeah. Obviously, Motown was based in Detroit at the time.
Yeah.
Was it a thing where you thought about working with Motown as a young musician? A lot of people from Detroit will say, you know, you were either at the auto plant or you were a musician or both. I mean, were those the options that were set out for you, or did you have others?
I wasn't at the auto plant. I was just this kid, you know, running around and being immersed in that music and other genres as well. I mean, I listened to a lot of rock and roll. I started listening to jazz in later years as, you know, as an early teenager. But I remember as a kid, the first jazz record I listened to was Lee Morgan's Sidewinder. You know, I wore that thing out. And so I had everything coming at me. And I was too young to go to the Motown Review. I never went to one of those. But, you know, I had that music and, you know, it was just wonderful growing up in that time that was growing up as well. But I remember in high school telling friends of mine that I would eventually play with Stevie Wonder. I don't know. I mean, it was in my gut. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I had the posters of him on my walls and everything. And I really absorbed his music. And I just felt like I had this connection with him. And I had never met him before. I'd seen him twice in concert. But I just remember telling people, I'm going to play with him one day. And, you know, you say things and you don't realize that you're actually implementing God's purpose already. But when you have that gut feeling, that's what's happening, you know. And I didn't realize it at the time, but you know, there's another story that led to that meeting. So
you can tell us that story.
Would you like to hear that story?
Sure.
Okay, fine. Well, I'm so glad you asked, Jeff. So what happened was, there was a friend of mine who was a drummer, and he was asked by a former band member of Stevie's to audition for him in New York. So when I heard about this, I was thrilled, obviously, for my good friend.
Ricky Lawson.
And he, you know, we played in a band together. I used to go with one of his sisters. I mean, you know, we were very good friends. So I went to his house the night before he left to hang with him and congratulate him. And we were talking, and we were all excited and everything. And he's packing, and, you know, we're in the basement. And he said to me at one point, right, so I want you to play some stuff on a cassette. And a cassette, right? So what happened was there were these little things called cassettes, and they actually had tape inside. And you would throw the thing, and they had the special machines that played these cassettes. And you could record on them or play back. And so what happened was I played some things on a cassette, and he said he would give it to Stevie. And I thought, well, you know, you don't need to do this. But he insisted. This is the kind of friend he was. So he left the next day, man. And some time passed. It seemed like an eternity, of course. But it was probably 2 or 3 days. And then I get a call from him early one morning, and he says, Stevie Wonder wants to see you in New York today. What do you do? So I'm running around the house like a banshee, man. I'm screaming. I'm grabbing clothes. My mom's getting ready to go to work, and she's like, what is the matter with you? I said, Stevie Wonder wants to see me in New York. So she says, okay, well, just bring clean underwear, because, you know, that's the... that's what moms do. They just want you to not soil your underwear. That's the only thing. If you get in a car crash, it's like, but was his underwear clean? That's all they care about. Not how many gashes you have in your head, you know. Did you have clean underwear? So I'm running around, I'm preparing, but check this out. I'm instructed, on my way to the airport to stop by Stevie's house to pick up one of his brothers. So now I get to go inside Stevie Wonder's house. So I go to in Detroit, and, you know, there were a bunch of us who knew where he lived, you know. It was a street called Cherry Lawn. And, you know, there were the urban legends that, you know, occasionally you could walk by the house and see Stevie Wonder in the backyard shooting hoops. But, you know, I never got to see, but I'm not, you know, it probably did happen because, you know, he's crazy like that. Also, you don't want to play air hockey with him. He will crush you. He, you know, you think I'm kidding. I've done it. It's true. So I'm at the house. So I'm sitting now inside Stevie Wonder's house. I'm going, okay, here I am. I'm just looking around. I'm in Stevie Wonder's house. And I'm waiting for his brother, one of his brothers, Timothy, to come down. So he comes down. We go to the airport, and we go to New York. And I get settled, and I arrive there, and I go, wow, New York. Skyscrapers and everything. So I'm looking, and so then I go to the studio. It was the original Hit Factory in New York, and I'm sitting there on pins and needles, man, because, you know, come on, I'm getting ready to meet my all-time idol. I'm sitting there, and I'm trying to be cool, and I'm talking to the engineers, and they know what's going. They know what I'm going through. They just know. But I'm trying to. I'm like, okay, yeah, this is good. Fine. And so I'm looking around the control room, and I'm like, okay, fine. And so in the control room, there was a monitor, and you could see who was coming in and out. It was an elevator. There was only one way to get in and out. It was this elevator. So they put a monitor by the elevator, and you could see who goes in and out. So it seemed like another eternity passes, but finally I'm looking up at the monitor. The elevator door opens, and out comes his sister, and she's guiding him in, and he's, you know, walking in the thing. And so then he walks in the room, and they say, Stevie, Greg is here. And this handshake from him was the single most life-changing event when I met him. It's like, how you doing? I'm like, oh, I think I soiled my pants. So, you know, I met, and then we had some small talk. You know, he showed me a song that he, you know, wanted to see if I would learn on the spot. What are you going to do? You just got to follow along. And, you know, we played around a little bit and talked. And then the next day was more of the formal audition for me. And it was between me and this older-looking white guy. He was another keyboardist. And so I go and I meet the rest of the band. And there were people like Niecy Williams, who was in the band at the time. And she went on to have a great solo career. And I remember one of the first things Niecy did was she walked by me and pinched me on the butt. You know, they were very informal then. And, you know, I was obviously nervous, but I remember certain band members coming up to me at different points going, it's okay, don't you got it, don't worry about it, it's okay. So, you know, we played and did stuff all day, and then that evening, I'm in the car with Stevie on the way back to the Hit Factory. And so I'm riding there, and all of a sudden he turns around and says, so, how does it feel to be a member of Wonderlove? I go, really? Now my mind is like, because I'm here, I'm thinking about all these things I heard about him, like he's a practical joker and he'd never know if he's serious or not. So I said, are you serious? And he said, of course. I said, well, then would you mind telling my mom? The figure, you ain't gonna lie to mom. So he said, sure. So we go back to the studio, and I dial the house, give him the phone. The first voice my mom hears is his, saying that, you know, he wants to have her son in my band, in his band, rather, and, you know, he's gonna take care of me and all this stuff, you know. So I can't remember exactly what he said, but... you know, they had a short talk, and he hands the phone back to me, and this is what you hear for about the next 10 minutes. Needless to say, I was...
Did I blow this?
Needless to say, I was excited. I was happy, and I was thrilled. And, you know, because my mom thought this was going to be a weekend fling, and I was just going to come back home, and that would be that. But... It was a weekend fling, and I did go back home to get the rest of my stuff because I was moving to New York. Now, here's the crazy thing. My dear friend Ricky did not get the gig. But Roy Ayers, who knows Roy Ayers? Who knows of him? Okay. Oh, good. So Roy Ayers was hanging around a lot of the time, and he says, well, if you don't get it with him, I'll take you. So Ricky ended up with Roy. And but years later, you know, he ended up with Stevie and Phil Collins and everybody else in between. And now this all happened April 2nd, 1975, a month before I turned 19. But a month before Stevie turned 25. I'm saying that he was 25 years old. And he was working on songs in the key of life at 25. Which means he was a lot younger when he was working on Music of My Mind, Talking Book, Inner Visions, and Fulfilling This First Finale. He was has that sunken in yet? He was 25. So... I managed to record 4 songs with him on that album.
Not bad.
Not bad.
When you when you're a keyboardist,
that's all you gotta say. Not bad. The song's in the key of life, man.
Just giving you a hard time.
Yeah. What did you do when you were 19? No, I'm kidding.
I was listening to you.
I kid. I'm sorry. Yeah. I had a David Foster moment. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah.
You're auditioning for, an artist.
Yeah.
Who's a giant already.
Yeah.
But not only that, he plays the same instrument as you.
Yeah.
So what is that like, actually trying to develop on your own and then, you know, be under this?
It was nerve-wracking because, well, the thing about the audition cassette was I wanted to let him know musically that I felt I understood how he thinks. So one of the things I played on the cassette was "The Sunshine of My Life." You know, "You Are the Sun." So what I... Okay, here we go again. Now, the other side of this story, there's like a backstory. And that is that when Ricky was told he didn't get the gig, obviously he was a little disappointed, so he leaves, his tail between his legs. And just as he was leaving the building, I guess, maybe it was the studio, I'm not sure exactly where it was, but as he was leaving, he's back out on the street and he realizes that he still has the cassette that he promised he was going to give. So he goes back and says to one of Stevie's managers, he says, "Look, you know, I have a good friend of mine and he plays keyboards and I promised him I'd, you know, give this cassette to Stevie. If you could just please make sure he listens to it." And the guy took it and he put it on a stack of other cassettes that Steve had on this table, right? And Steve wasn't there at the time. But when he got back, you know, he's rifling through cassettes. He picks mine up and he puts it in the machine and he plays it. And he's, he's like listening and he's listening. And then he stops it and he takes it out and he says, "What does this cassette say?" So then the manager said, "Well, it says Greg," and of course he butchered the last name. It was like Greg Phillinganes. And so then Stevie reportedly said, "Find him. Get this guy." And so they called poor Ricky back and they said, "Ricky," and he's like, "You changed your mind?" And they said, "Not exactly, but you know, your friend, can you find that guy? Stevie wants to see him." So that's when Ricky called me and said that he wanted to see me. Because apparently, the story goes, and this is how the manager explained it to me, that Stevie thought that it was him. And he couldn't figure out when he played it. He thought he was listening to himself. Which is the ultimate compliment, because that's what I set out to do. I didn't realize it was to that degree that he thought he was actually listening to himself. So, you know, that was explained to me years later, but that was the backstory to that.
Well, you mentioned songs in the key of life.
Yeah.
And performing on that.
Yeah.
Why don't we listen to something that you performed on?
Sure.
Stevie was a prodigy. You got into this music business very young. Did he pass along any advice to you, anything like that? Was it that type of relationship?
Well, I mean, it's not like we had late night campfire talks, but my experience was tremendous because while I didn't make it through, I did try college, by the way, but I sucked at it. Even the stuff I liked, it was just tanking, you know. And so I always say I didn't go to college, but I went to Wonder U. Because what happened was in the band Wonderlove that he had at the time, it was basically just an extension of him. And all we did was he used us to formulate a lot of his ideas. And, you know, so you had to be very flexible. And we just spent hours playing all different kinds of stuff, you know, whether it was working out different lines or working out endings or intros to songs he already had, whatever, or playing any kind of genre. I mean, he could go in and out of any style, you know, classical, Latin, Afro-Cuban, pop, reggae, anything. Yeah. And so you developed a keen sense of the mechanics of each genre, like what makes reggae reggae, what makes country country, what, you know what I mean? And he could play any kind of style, and that was the most invaluable thing that I got from the years I spent with him.
Did you have a sense, even just playing on four tracks, of the magnitude of Songs in the Key of Life as it was being made?
No, I mean, I get asked that all the time. I get asked the same thing about Thriller. But no, we just knew that we were making a great record and it was gonna be pretty big and important. And Motown was impatiently waiting. At one point, he had T-shirts made that we all wore that said, "We're almost finished." I remember that. We're almost finished, because it was like the anticipation was like, Stevie, you know?
It was 2 years in the making
or
more.
Oh, yeah. It seemed like 20, you know? But, yeah, and it was well worth the wait. And I remember when it was finally released, the big ad campaign, or one of the big parts of the ad campaign, was this massive wraparound billboard in Times Square. Mm-hmm. And it, you know, it had the album cover and it had him, and it's like, you know, Songs in the Key of Life, released on, you know, I should know the day by heart, but that date was recently celebrated. It's like 40, I think it was like last month, 40 years ago. Is when it was released, but yeah, it was pretty pretty amazing. We knew it was something special, for sure.
Yeah,
yeah. Just not how special.
How did you meet these gentlemen? All right, so that was the Jacksons.
Yeah.
Shake Your Body Down from the Destiny album.
Yeah.
For which you did arrangements.
I did the rhythm arrangements.
Yeah.
Meaning, you know, for you know, the rhythm section, you know, the everything but the horns and the strings.
So how did you come to work with the Jacksons?
Well,
there was a very good friend of mine, Bobby Colombi, who was an executive and a producer at CBS at the time. And he talked to me about arranging, even though I had done, you know, a good amount of arranging for artists that were on the Solar label that Dick Griffey and Don Cornelius had, as they really, you know, gave me freedom to, you know, express my chops that way. I did a bit of that, but you know, I wasn't fully confident yet, I don't think. And Bobby said, "Well, you know, you should do more arranging." And I thought, "I don't know." He says, "Yeah, actually, you should, and actually, you will, and actually, here's who you're going to do it with." Next thing I know, I'm in a room with the Jacksons. I'm like, oh, hi, fellas, how you doing? And yeah, it was for the Destiny album, which was a big deal for them because they were, you know, breaking away from the whole Motown and even the Philly connection. And they were basically on their own, but CBS didn't completely trust them yet. So they sent in Bobby and said, we'll just kind of check things out and make sure they don't go willy-nilly, you know.
That was their first time writing some of their own material.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And Shake Your Body was one of them. But the first arrangement I did was Blame It on the Boogie. And, you know, you know, so I came up with that bit. And for Shake Your Body, they, you know, they played me the demo. They just had the groove. That's all you had was, you know, dun, 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 right? They didn't have a groove to it. They just had, bah, 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 da, da, which was great. And I thought, let's see, how could we really make this hot, you know? And after having just worked with Stevie, I mean, he was obviously my main inspiration for, you know, for life. And, but the inspiration for that song in particular, I thought, well, what would Stevie do? Even with Blame It on the Boogie, that was the same thought, but especially for this, what would Stevie do? So I know you, I noticed that you liked the drum groove. Well, I came up with that. And I wish we had drums here, because if we did, I could show you that I can still play it. In its entire, I can play the whole thing. But what happened was the drummer that played on the track is a brilliant guy named Ed Green. But he couldn't do it. He couldn't do the whole thing, right? We had to do it in three separate passes. So what? The first pass was just
the groove, right? Just that, right?
And the whole way through. Then the second pass was with the tom-toms.
Actually, just the toms, because he already laid down the first part, right? So just the toms was put up, right, for the second pass.
And then the third pass was that crazy hi-hat part that goes, right? That's all he did was for the third pass. So when you put it all together, you got, right? So, and I came up with that because having spent all that time with Stevie, he has he can play drums, but it's very unorthodox style Stevie has of playing drums, and he would do like insane stuff, and you just can't imagine a human being able to do this. So it was based off of Stevie's unorthodox style of drumming that I came up with that pattern. And then, you know, of course, the synth bass, you know, I'm all over that. So that was totally inspired by Stevie as well. And you notice on the piano track, it's got like a chorus effect on it. Well, it's not an effect. What I did was I played one pass down completely and then recorded another pass playing the same piano but sped the tape up a little bit. So when he slowed it back down, it created that chorus almost like honky-tonk piano effect. And that's how it did. That's how we did it in the old days. Now you just press a button and it's chorus. But you had to work hard back in those days. You had to work at it. So that's how that track developed. And of course, the guys thought I was crazy when I came up with that beat. You know, like, the hell is this? But then when they heard it back all together, they thought, oh, this is really cool. So,
what did you observe about Michael in this period? Because I feel like, you know, everyone talks about Off the Wall, about Thriller. But these albums, these Jacksons albums,
they were the lead ups to that.
They feel like
absolutely.
They were.
Absolutely.
I mean, was that up to your observation as well?
Well, I didn't know what was to come. Yeah. See, so I just knew that at that time, he and all the brothers were just, you could feel the sense of liberation, you know, and excitement that they were on their own. And so by the time they got the Triumph, they were completely on their own. And they brought me back in to do more rhythm arrangements. But that was pretty much, you know, the springboard for them. You know, the Destiny album was pretty much the springboard for their newfound creativity.
What did you observe about Michael, just even as a songwriter, as a performer in the studio, you know, in those albums?
Well, he was meticulous about the parts, and you know, he treated the parts of his songs like characters. Every sound was a character, and he was totally able, like, he couldn't play every instrument. I mean, he dabbled in piano. There's actually a picture of us at a piano. He dabbled at piano, and he could play drums. Bet you didn't know that, huh? I was in a studio once, and, you know, we were just mulling around, and all of a sudden I heard this groove. And I peeped around, and it's Michael on drums. I'm like, oh, that's a little different. But then when you think about it, it makes perfect sense because he was a dancer, you know? And just like Sammy Davis Jr., who was an unbelievable dancer, tap dancer, he played drums as well, so it made sense. But yeah, he was able to totally you know, reproduce the sound he wanted, the sound he had in his mind at the time, whatever it was, especially when it came to those percussive guitar parts, you know, like for Wannabe Starting Something, where he goes, and he found a guy, David Williams, who was brilliant at that, and he was able to completely and accurately reproduce exactly the vibe and attitude Michael wanted for those kind of parts.
Mm-hmm. Well, before we get into Thriller, let's talk a little bit about this.
Whoa.
Yeah. Oh boy. Oh boy. Where do I begin? Yeah, I got some stories for you about that song right there. Do you want to hear them?
Yes.
You want to hear all of them?
All of them.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, be careful what you ask for. All right, well, we'll start with the easy light stuff first. And I'm looking for a particular picture in my phone. That's why I'm doing this. So, trust me, it'll be worth it. This picture will be the punchline to the other story. So I'm not ignoring you. I'm just trying to find this thing. So, oh, I found the picture. Okay, good. So many things about this. Oh, dear. Well, the vocal, for instance, the lead vocal, you know, it's mostly the... Now, when he originally did it, that's all there was. It was just, the melody was just staying there in that register. But again, you know, the brilliance of Quincy as producer, he had Michael sing some answers in a lower register just to make sure all the girls knew he was still a man, you know. And it was important, right? Because imagine just listening to that without him doing those lower answers. It'd be a little different, wouldn't it? He'd be like, oh, he just sounds like a girl. I know that. Right? But when he goes, oh, that's it. And then you're like, oh, I get it. Yeah, baby, yeah. So see, that's what Quincy was going for. So there's that. Just a little producing technique, you know, but that was his brilliance. He was always thinking about, okay, how can we maximize his sex appeal? So there's that. Now, let's see. So now we go back to the beginning of this when Michael actually asked me to come to the house. to potentially do some writing with him. And so I go there, and he says, well, I have this song. I want you to check it out. So he plays a demo. And what I heard essentially was, you know, all the little bottles and all that, and ding, 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 and you know, I heard all that. And the chorus, you know, keep on with the dust up, all that stuff. I thought, this is really cool, you know. And but then he said, it needs another part. So I said, well, does that sound like him? It's pretty good, right? It's good. She's tripping. She's like, is he in the room? Trust me, I can't get him out of my head either. Trust me. He's just, Greg. And he used to call me Gregory, because my full name is Gregory. But it's Gregory. He used to be real country, you know. And they used to make fun of me because I love breakfast. It's probably my favorite meal of the day. And back then, I was like really skinny, and I can eat like 3-4 breakfasts at a time. And they would all laugh at me. They go, oh, look at Greg eating all that breakfast. But that's a side note. So anyway, he says, that's true, though. But he said, you know, it just needs this one more part. So I'm sitting there thinking, I'm at the piano, and so I think just for a couple of minutes, and then I came up with right? So I came up with that, and this happened over the course of, like, it was very quick, you know, because I was just, that just hit me, right? So I said, well, what do you think? He goes, I like it. I go, yeah? He says, yeah. So now I'm thinking, well, we got the verse, we got the hook, we got the bridge, so that's pretty much it, right? Yeah, so I says, well, so you like it, right? He goes, yeah. He says, well, I said, well, so you're good with this? He says, yeah. I says, well, so can I get a piece? And he said, yeah. Oh, yeah? He said, yeah. I said, so, well, what do you think? And he goes, what do you think? And I go, what do you think? He goes, what do you? So this went on for like, so now I'm like, you know, the gears are spinning in the head again. I'm like, okay, all right, let's see now. Now, look, you have to understand something. You guys today, you're very, very business savvy. You guys got your own labels. You know, you probably have your own printing presses. You got everything going on. And so this is a whole different thing, and God bless you for that. That's great, because you should be. But back then, I wasn't one of the smart ones. But anyway, so I'm trying to figure out, okay, now what? So I start off with, let's see, 50%? No, that won't work. 40? Nah, let's see. I'm talking myself down. This is all going on in a matter of seconds. So I'm thinking, okay, 30, 25, maybe, I don't know. 20, could be 15. Well, so I finally settle on 10. 10%. So I go, well, what do you think about 10%? He goes, okay. I went, really? He said, yeah. So I'm like, so I'm just flying home, right? I'm like, this is great. I just wrote a song with Michael Jackson. So, you know, some time passes, and I get something in the mail. And I open it up, and it's a contract. And I'm rifling through the thing, and it says my name at the top. Of course, they misspelled it. It was a T instead of a P. I didn't even pay it. I didn't even realize that. I just was like looking through the thing. And then I scroll down, and I see 10%. I go, it's in there, 10%. I'm in it. It's great. I was 10%. So I'm thrilled beyond belief. And so more time passes, and
I get a call from one of his managers at that time. It was either, his name was Fred DeMann or Ron Weisner, one of those guys, called me. I think it was Fred. And he said, yeah, you know that contract? I said, yeah, listen, I'm just about to send it back. No worries. Thank you so much. This is fantastic. He says, well, not so fast. I said, why? He said, well, because Michael's been thinking about it, and he's kind of had a, he's come to the conclusion that what you did was an arrangement. So don't bother sending that back. Thanks for your service. So now I could have been one of those guys to go, oh, hell no. And I could have, you know, gotten a lawyer and I could have gone at him. Because, you know, this was at, by this point, it was pretty late in the game. And the first pressing of the single was already done. But I didn't. I was deeply heartbroken and I let it go. I don't know what you would have done in that situation, but that's what I did. I mean, I was young and it was Michael Jackson and I thought, well, I don't have a chance. And so I just ate it. I was very heartbroken, like I said, and that's what happened. But now Quincy didn't realize, he thought that I was in, he thought that, the deal was done, and he was thrilled for me, and didn't realize it until after the fact. And he was upset too, but you know, it's nothing he could do either. So, but just to show you how close I came to being a co-writer with Michael Jackson, I just happen to have here a picture of the first pressing. Would you like to see it? Can we get a close-up? Do you see this right here? Okay, watch this. Are you getting this? Yeah? Are you zooming right in there? Okay. Okay, so for those of you who can't, that's the thing right there. So for those of you who can't see, it says, Epic.
Quincy Jones Productions. Don't stop till you get enough.
M. Jackson, G. Phillinganes. Well, don't clap. Don't clap, because all I got is a picture. I didn't get any royalties. Actually, a colleague of mine actually gave me a 45, the actual 45. So I have it at home. But unfortunately, that's all I got. So there's a lesson in there. And you can take it for what it's worth. It was a tough pill for me to swallow, but on the other side of that, you know, I maintained a relationship with him and his brothers throughout the years.
Yeah.
You know, and the last thing we did together was the 30th anniversary shows at Madison Square Garden just before the tragic 9/11, you know. But, you know, after everything I've been through with Michael being MD on his solo tours, you know, the Bad and Dangerous tours and all the stuff that I did with the brothers and all the years of, you know, relationships, to culminate in that moment where I'm sitting backstage in the dressing room with the brothers at Madison Square Garden, and I'm looking them in the face and I'm going, well, fellas, have a great show. Now, you got to understand that I never imagined that from being in junior high school, listening to, oh, baby, give me one more chance, you know, thinking that was the most exciting thing since the Beatles, to be in a room with them as their music director, telling them to have a great show. Do you understand the magnitude of that? And then to go to Michael's dressing room and tell him the same thing. I mean, it was
unspeakable. You know, unspeakable, joyous moment. So I lost out on one end, but, you know, what I gained, I don't think anyone can replace.
Yeah. What kind of, I mean, what kind of relationship do you feel with this material? You played on it when it was recorded. You've toured it. You revisited it, you know, in tribute. In some instances, as we've seen, you were co-writing it. Does that change over time? Is the material just the material? Does it change as you get older?
Well, that's kind of deep, Jeff. I never, looked at it like that. I don't know. I just think it's an intrinsic part of my, I would say my life as well, my career, as well as my career. Of course, I have my actual life, which is my family and my kids. That's my life. This stuff is what I do. My personal life and my family is who I am. So, you know, I made those distinctions. But it's just, I don't know, I just walk around with my own personal sense of joy and accomplishment to know that I was a part of some of the most influential music of the 20th century. But it's not like I walk around going, hey, I'm part of the most influential music. I mean, I actually enjoy the anonymity because, like you, I can go in a grocery store and you know, not get paparazzis out, you know. Yeah, it's just, it's a wonderful legacy to leave behind my kids, so they know that daddy wasn't just the guy that took out the garbage. you know, but no, it's the fact that, you know, projects like Songs in the Key of Life and Thriller and Off the Wall are still being celebrated today just shows you the timeless quality of it. And I am extremely proud to have, you know, not only participated in that small way musically, but having the relationships that developed over the years too.
Now, you mentioned going into Thriller, the expectation level was not anything beyond just doing this record.
No,
was that the case? Because I mean, there's stories about how Michael was very disappointed that Off the Wall didn't win more Grammys or didn't sell more, and he wanted to top himself.
But
was that a directive in terms of actual creative process of making the music?
Well, it was the only directive that we, as the musicians had, was from Quincy, was just to go in and do your best. Michael was at home, man, writing 100 million sales on the bathroom wall. You know, I mean, he took that real, and I didn't know all that was going on, but I mean, I, you know, learned later on that, you know, yes, he was extremely committed and wrote notes about, you know, how he wanted to impact the world and how many records he wanted to sell and all that. He was pretty precise about that. We didn't feel any kind of pressure because, you know, Quincy always, no matter what artist he was working with, if you were involved, he just made it fun, you know. And he had a very beautiful way of bringing out the best in anyone. And so that's all we did. It was just a continuation, really, of Off the Wall, where we were all together again making great music. We didn't go in saying, yes, we're going to make history. This is going to be incredible. You know, it wasn't like that. It's just, it was just a natural progression that we all enjoyed being a part of. And then, you know, we were working more with our dear brother Rod Temperton, who recently passed away, and
You know, he came in with that little ditto, that little ditty called Thriller. And then everything changed, you know.
What can you what can you tell these guys about Rod Temperton? Who he was and what his importance is?
Where do I start with this guy? Rod Temperton was you know, in school, like in high school, the yearbooks, they have like the different categories of people, like most likely to succeed and write that kind of thing. Well, I would imagine his little bio in that high school book saying, the guy you least expect to write massive hits. Because he was just this little skinny British guy from a little band called Heatwave. That he was a member of and wrote songs for them too. Little things like Boogie Nights, Always and Forever, Groove Line, Ain't No Half Steppin', all these hits. And Quincy plucked him out, you know, and brought him into the fold and said, "You're gonna write for Michael," because, again, the brilliance of Quincy. Understanding talent and understanding the potential for expanding that talent, and he realized that, or he felt that that Rod would be, you know, a great addition and a key element in the new version of Michael, and. Rod took on the challenge, but then he understood Michael musically too. I think that's why he fits so well, and that's why he was able to come up with, you know, these custom gems like "Off the Wall" and "Rock with You" and songs like that. And he was just a brilliant guy, and his methodology for songwriting. Oh my! Let me tell you, this guy was a consummate songwriter. And he brought new depth and meaning to the term doing your homework. This guy, in the creation of one song, would come up with 200 titles. Just freaking titles. 200 of them just so he can pare down and finally nail one to start a concept with. That's just the song title. He hadn't written a note yet. I'm just going to just come up with options for song titles. So he starts with that. And then everything is of painstaking detail. And all the little layers and details of parts, he came up with all of them. It's not like we were improvising. Every part came from him and we were duplicating that. Like all the little parts to Thriller and, you know, with all the multi layers of sounds and parts, that all came from him, and that was for every song.
Do you remember the original title to Thriller?
Starlight. Right.
Correct, sir.
The Starlight, and you know, Rod made these fantastic demos, and everything was great until you heard the vocal because he could not sing.
Let's listen to one of the demos actually for Starlight.
Not quite the same. but yeah, I think it was Quincy that said, we need something, a title with a little more of an edge, you know? So 200 titles later, Thriller. Okay, now we're on to something. And then that opened up a whole new world, you know? And Rod said that he knew that he wanted to have some kind of... voice to do, this spoken word section.
Did Rod write the spoken word section too?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You want to know how he wrote it? He wrote it in the taxi on the way from the airport to the studio. That's how he came up with the spoken, all that darkness fall. He was in the taxi going, see darkness fall. He was in the damn taxi. The taxi. That's how brilliant he was. He's like, well, I need some lyrics here. I think I'll
I said, I've got to go to the studio now. Right, and maybe I'll just do it now. Anyway, that's how that happened, yeah.
I think we should listen to this in full.
You know, it's good to the last drop. Now, I have to say some things about that. You know, it's good to the last drop. Now, how did you ever imagine that you'd be grooving to a dance tune with a pipe organ in it and Vincent Price rapping? Who does that? Come on, man. And it's like one of the greatest dance tracks of all time. And what I wanted to say about Rod, another element of his brilliance, was that he made sure that every section of his songs were equally as strong. You know, a lot of songs will have a great hook, and that's it. Or they'll have like a really interesting verse, and then the chorus just kind of, flutters away. No. With the Rod songs, the verse and the chorus and even the bridge, they could be separate songs on their own. Go back and check out his work, and you'll see that's right. And that was to his brilliance. I mean, the bridge of Thriller, that's a song right there. That's just the bridge. But that was the level of quality that he brought to every song, no matter who the artist was. Yeah. You know, even like with George Benson, "Give Me the Night," the same thing. If you listen to that, the bridge and the hook and the verse could be songs on their own. And Love Times Love, all that stuff. And so there's that. And then, you know, again, people ask me, do I remember what it was like being in the studio? I remember playing the parts and listening on the massive JBL speakers in the control room. It's just blasting, we're just rolling, and it was so much fun, reproducing the million parts that Rod came up with, and then the big pipe organ sound at the end. All that's me. It was crazy. It was. Just a crazy ride, and it's unforgettable.
Do you have a preference between Off the Wall and Thriller musically?
No, but as I said to Spike Lee when he asked me, he sort of asked that same question. He did a documentary on Off the Wall, and my answer was, well, there would be no Thriller without Off the Wall, because Thriller was the progression from Off the Wall. But Off the Wall had a uniqueness to it because there was a bit more of an innocence there. It was his coming out again as an adult. So it was a celebration of that. There was this charm to it. Yeah. You know what I mean? There were more organic elements to it, and Thriller was just, you know, a bigger production overall with fantastic songs on it, no question about it. But Off the Wall played a huge, significant role in the creation of Thriller. You wouldn't have had that without Off the Wall. You know?
And I mean, the songs off Thriller that are the biggest hits are also in some ways very, very dark. I mean, even subject matter wise. I mean, it was a different, when you say innocence, you know.
Yeah. There was a difference there as well, I'd say.
I think you can also sort of hear it in Michael's voice, you know, when you listen to say certain songs.
Yeah, there was just, you know, part of the natural maturity.
Yeah.
From the time spent between those albums and everything that was going on in his life and his development.
You've had the opportunity to revisit his material as well, in different contexts.
Yeah.
If you maybe want to briefly explain what those contexts are in recent years and...
Oh, you mean the Cirque du Soleil thing?
Yeah, just real quick.
So I was asked by the Michael Jackson Estate and Cirque du Soleil to be the music director for a little project they were working on called the Michael Jackson Immortal.
I don't know if any of you saw it, but it was a traveling arena show, and it was celebrating Michael's music, and it involved, you know, the classic elements of Cirque du Soleil with a band that I put together and singers and dancers and everything, and but you know, the star of the show obviously was Michael, and we played to his vocals, but also to custom arranged tracks of, you know, many of his hits from, you know, different eras in his career. And, you know, we all played in sync to a click track, but, you know, the star obviously was his voice. And it was interesting. It was fun. There were elements of it that were enjoyable. There were elements of it that were not enjoyable. But it was a pretty unique experience, I'd say. And, yeah, I guess it worked. It went around all around the world. I did it for 18 months. And after I left, it still went on for almost another year.
What do you want people to remember about Michael Jackson as a person?
That he cared. He cared about life. He cared about people. He cared about music. He was a dreamer. He was very quietly passionate about, you know, all things about all aspects of life. He loved to laugh. He was a big goofball. He was extremely sensitive. You know, he was a complex individual, and he had, you know, many different sides, as we all do, really. I mean, it's no surprise there. But he cared, you know. There were things that he felt that were in his control to do, and then there were things that he felt that he couldn't control. But yeah, there was a complexity there, but he did love life, and he felt that he understood his role to the best that he could have. There were things that he did that, you know, were unhealthy, that didn't necessarily help him continue. And then people also don't realize that when he had that accident during that Pepsi commercial and his scalp caught on fire, they didn't realize the intense pain that is caused by that. And people talk about later years, you know, the dependency on painkillers. But man, you have third-degree burns on your scalp, it's going to leave a mark. And you know, the dependency on those painkillers were one of the things that brought him down. But the strength he had to try to continue as an artist through all of those adversities is really quite remarkable. It's really stunning. He was a fighter. And he got to a point, I think, where, you know, he was losing the fight, but he was a fighter for sure. But if there's any one thing, I would say that he just cared. You know what? When we're working on, let's see, Destiny, it's. I think the question was raised at one point, you know, what kind of equipment I had, and I remember saying that I didn't have an electric piano. I didn't have a Fender Rhodes, you know. And, you know, and time passed, and, you know, thought nothing else about it. And then I'm at home one day, and a doorbell rings, and it's this delivery guy. And he says, "Are you Greg Phillinganes?" I go, "Yeah." He says, "Well, I have something for you." So he opens the back of this truck, and out comes this box with a Fender Rhodes in it. And there was a note that says, "Well, dear Greg, I know you didn't have one of these, so I thought you might like it." It was a typewritten note, and it said Michael Jackson, but he didn't sign it. But he sent me a Fender Rhodes electric piano, and it's still in use. I still have it. It's a beautiful 73 keyboard Rhodes, and I a few years back had it, you know, tweaked and refurbished, and it sounds beautiful, and that's you know, an example of his care for people.
You've been blessed to experience some real full circle type of moments in your career.
Oh my Lord, yes.
From starting with Stevie playing on his Songs in the Key of Life tour last year.
Well, yeah, you got to hear the progression of this. Yeah. You got to dig the progression of this. Okay, so now you know that I started with him on Songs in the Key of Life, right? So that's the first bit. And then the second bit was, you know, he would have these annual Christmas charity events called, what was it called? I see it in my head. I can't. Anyway, it was a Christmas charity event. I can't remember the name of it, so I'm having a brain fart right now. But so let's see. A few years back, he decided he wanted to perform Songs in the Key of Life live, and it would be the first time ever. So there was that full circle moment. And then after that, touring that album, that's another full circle moment. And then there was a TV show, a Grammy tribute to him honoring that album, that I won an Emmy for. So there's that full circle moment. So there's like four full circle moments just off of that album, you know. And it's mind-blowing. And I've had a couple other full circle moments in other with other artists. Mm-hmm. But just that album alone, I mean, it's my experience with him literally was the gift that keeps on giving.
Yeah. You know?
Yeah. So
why do you think you've been so fortunate?
It's all God. It has nothing to do with me. I mean, I he gives you these dreams, and then, you know, your belief in those dreams and in him, he lays it all out. I mean, I could have never imagined ever, man, being a kid in Detroit and listening to these artists, man, from Stevie to Eric Clapton to the Beatles to, you know, Pink Floyd. I never imagined I'd be in their company, working with them, in some cases having relationships with them. I never imagined. And it's been a wonderful, wonderful ride, and we'll see what happens from this point on, but you know, it's a lot of memories there. Thank you very much.